morning. Welcome to worship at Trinity Lutheran Church on this gorgeous Sunday morning. As we begin our day, or near the beginning of our day, we are blessed by the Lord's presence, a presence we can take with us throughout this day and the days ahead. One announcement, as you may see some items over here. These are the school supplies that we collected. Now, it's just a small sample of the school supplies we collected. There's not even one of every item that we collected. There's more in terms of the variety that we collected. Plus, there was a lot more of each of them as well. So we took them over to the school. They were going to distribute them as there was need. They decided not to go for the passing them out in a large gathering, you know, like we used to do in the past. And so, but the children will receive these supplies. And we thank you for donating them. Are there any other announcements? Excuse me. Just a reminder that we are having the closing event of our 125th anniversary celebration on September 12th. And that is a picnic. And there will be one service, 10 o'clock, outdoors, followed by the picnic. If there are no other announcements, then let us pray for worship through our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. The questions you raise when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trust us in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, we are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, we are shown God's mercy. We are forgiven and loved into abundant life.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
This service is really an extended prayer with petitions for students and teachers and for parents and so forth. And like our prayers of intercession, to the words, Lord, in your mercy, the response is, hear our prayer. God is the source of all wisdom and knowledge. Let us ask him to bless those who seek to learn and their teachers. For students, as they begin this new school year, that the Spirit of God may grant them the gifts of wisdom, understanding, and delight in their learning. Lord, in your mercy. For teachers, as they may share their knowledge with gentleness and patience and concern for their students, give them support and affirmation in their vital role as teachers. Lord, in your mercy. For parents, the first teachers of their children, their role is vital too. We pray that their faith and love may be a source of encouragement to their children and a support to the teachers who have charge of them. Lord, in your mercy. We ask your blessing upon the supplies that have been gathered for this school year, and upon those who gave them. May our schools receive what they need to successfully accomplish the goals of their learning enterprise. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, our God, in your wisdom and love, you surround us with the mysteries of the universe. In times long past, you sent us your prophets to teach your ways and to bear witness to your undying love. You sent us your Son to teach us by word and example that true wisdom comes from you alone. Send your spirit upon these students and their teachers and fill them with your wisdom and blessings. Grant that during this academic year, they may devote themselves to their studies and share what they have learned from others. Grant this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's see, do we have any students here today? I'm a lifelong student, I can tell you that. How about any teachers? You just in?
Yeah.
Yeah? Yes, please. Any others? Wait a minute, I know there's another one out there. Roger? Roger, you're a college professor, aren't you?
Close enough.
Close enough. Anyone else that's working in our school systems in other capacities? Well, we ask God's blessing upon each and every one of you. A reading from Joshua, the 24th chapter. Then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Now therefore revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight. He protected us all along the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In our home, right next to the entrance door, there's a tapestry that was made by a member of a congregation I served a long, long time ago. And it's got a house on it. And it says, "In our household, we will serve the Lord." That's what it's saying, Joshua. And we hung it up wherever we've gone. Please read responsibly with me from Psalm 34. "The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry.
The face of the Lord is against evil doers, but our remembrance of them for the other."
When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and rescues them from all their troubles.
The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit.
Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord rescues them from them all. Evil brings death to the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned.
The Lord redeems his life by his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned.
The second lesson is a reading from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, the 6th chapter. "Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, having done everything, to stand firm. Stand therefore and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, Put on whatever makes you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Kelvin's mom was in the kitchen drinking her morning cup of coffee. Kelvin walks in. He's got a space helmet on his head, And he's got this long cape that's so long it just sort of extends out behind him. And she says to him, "Well, what's up today?" And he says, "Well, nothing so far." And she says, "So far?" And he says, "Yeah, but you never know. Something could come up. And when it does, I'm going to be ready." Kelvin walks out the door to go play. His mom says, "You know, I need a suit like that." God talks about another kind of suit in our lesson for today. It's a suit of armor. Shield, it says. A belt. A breastplate. Shoes. And a sword. Helmet. And I wanted to share with you a little bit of what that suit is all about. As we might one day just sit there drinking our coffee and say, "Boy, I sure need a suit like that." For instance, it's a belt. Is it the belt of truth? The belt of truth? Oh. A breastplate. Can you read what it says on it?
Righteous.
The breastplate of righteousness. The helmet of salvation. A shield. A shield of faith. Shoes. Got a shoes. But you know, they're not for running away. They are for running to tell people the good news of God's peace, which we have. We've got shoes to do that. Sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. These are the pieces of armor that God has given us to protect us from what our lesson describes as arrows. This is what Satan uses. Here's the arrow of guilt. Well, if it doesn't have that on, it boom, bounces right off, doesn't it? Here is the arrow of accusation. But I got a shield of faith. And if it misses there, I still got the breastplate. How about lies? Does Satan use lies to deceive us? Yep, but I'm protected against that. But the belt of truth. Oh, did I miss that? Oh, yeah, yeah. Wow. With the belt of truth. I can hold my thing on better with this one, too. Yeah. So God has given us these suits of armor, these pieces of armor, as a defense against all the things that Satan can throw at us. Notice that most of the weapons, the only thing that is a weapon of offense is the sword. And that can be used to open up an area that's infected so it can be healed. It can also be used to cut someone free that's in bondage. But that's what God gives us to protect us from slavery, to cut us free. All these are defensive weapons because the devil uses offensive weapons. He uses the arrows. He's on the attack. And God is saying, this is spiritual warfare, and you don't attack with more attack. You don't fight lies with bigger lies, but with the truth. You really don't fight war with war. You don't bring peace with war. It just kind of moves around a little bit. You bring an end to war with an attitude of peace. Maybe you've experienced this. Charlie Brown, he's the pitcher for his team, you know. And he's on the pitcher's mound, and he's saying, you're remembering a piece of scripture. That's the word of God, right? Remembering a piece of scripture. And he says, just as he's about to pitch, he says, though I walk in darkness, I will not be afraid. Though I walk in the night, I will not know terror. He's building up his confidence in the word. He throws the ball, and the ball came roaring back, and says, pow! And it catapults him into the air upside down. And he lands on his back on the mound. And he looks up and he says, but those line drives will kill you. Maybe we've experienced that too, those line drives in life that are out to kill us. They come from the evil one. And God gives us these weapons of defense against them. And he says, put them all on. Put them all on. Not just one or two, but wear them all. Because they work. They work. You know this breastplate? It's not mine anymore. It actually belongs to God. It's not only his gift to me, but he actually wears it. And that helmet of salvation? Yeah, that's his too. It says in Isaiah chapter 59, for instance, when Isaiah the prophet is talking about all the injustice that is going on in the kingdom and all the unrighteousness, and God says, who will intervene? And there's no one to intervene. And so God says, well, then I will find victory with my own arm. I will put on the breastplate of righteousness and the helmet of salvation. And those items actually are Jesus Christ. He is our righteousness. Three times in the gospel, or the book of Acts, rather, it calls Jesus the righteous one. His perfect obedience to his Father, to the very end, is his righteousness. And he gives that to us with the breastplate that really is his. And with the helmet of salvation, Jesus wore a helmet himself. Yeah. We don't think of it that way. We think of the crown of thorns, that actually it was more shaped like a helmet that covered his head completely, in which they pushed down on him. For him, it was painful, agonizing. But for us, it becomes the helmet of salvation. These things work, because God has given us the promise that they will. You know, maybe we need a suit like that. World War I, the end of World War I. And I have a history professor, so I'm sure I'm probably going to get this wrong. You can talk to me after the sermon. But my understanding is that after World War I, Germany was treated mercilessly. They were punished economically, militarily, in terms of their identity as a nation and their pride as a nation. And they were really squelched. And about two decades later, they started another war, World War II. And after that war, there was something called the European Recovery Program, which tried to help Europe recover in many different ways, economically especially. The surprising factor in this is that Germany was included in the program. The enemy, the one who started the war. And I always wondered, if Germany had been treated that way in the First World War, if things could have been different. Japan, it was the same thing. They rebuilt Japan economically. Their society changed. Women took on a more active and role at a higher status, for instance. And even at the end of that, there was the period called the formation of alliances, in which these entities eventually became our friends, our colleagues. I know it doesn't always work that way. Satan can be really tenacious. But these are the things that God has given us to give us the kind of life that is good for all. It's a suit that maybe we need. And it's a suit that helps us stand firm. That's the last thing to say. There was a woman by the name of Sarah Corson. She was a missionary down to South America. And she was there to build agricultural projects, you know, for a little community down there that she had visited before. And one night, about 30 armed soldiers came into the compound and rushed into their houses, started ransacking the place, started looking for, obviously, weapons, perhaps, or things that might be part of supportive of the resistance. And Sarah was terrified because she had heard from a friend who had been near the camp, the military camp, that the soldiers were saying they were going to exterminate the Americans because they were responsible for the resistance that was against the government that had newly formed them. Well, when they came in, the commander put his gun in Sarah's chest or stomach. And she said, "We're just here to give some agricultural help and to teach the Bible." And he said, "I've never read the Bible. I think it's a communist thing, isn't it?" She said, "Well, would you permit me to read you something?" And he said, "Okay." And she read the Sermon on the Mount and came to that place where it says, "Love your enemies." And he said, "That's impossible." And she said, "For people it is, but not for God." and for those who rely on his strength. It's not impossible. And from that point on, she showed him every kindness that she could. As a matter of fact, they were having a worship service the next day, and she invited him to come. And he did, and they welcomed him with hugs. This is what that commander said to her. I could have fought any amount of guns you might have had, but there is something here I cannot understand, and I cannot fight it. And then his last words to Sarah were, I have fought many battles and killed many people. It was nothing to me. It was just my job to exterminate them. But I never knew them personally. This is the first time I ever knew my enemy face to face. And I believe that if we knew each other, our guns would not be necessary. Sarah, with kindness, but also with courage, stood firm to her faith. And I think that for all of us, there are times when we can look at the armor God has provided and say, I sure could use a suit like that. Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. For our prayers of intercession, the response to the words, Lord, in your mercy, is again, hear our prayer. May children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of courage, bless all leaders of your church. Make them ready to proclaim the gospel of peace and strengthen them to preach your loving word. Lord, in your mercy. God of creation, bless fields and orchards. Protect the land from drought and bring life-giving rain to support growth. Instruct your people in wise treatment of the world you have provided for all your creatures. Lord, in your mercy. God of community, bless all who seek justice between nations and peoples. Give guidance to bridge builders, heal divisions, and inspire cooperation in times of crisis, disaster, and even war. Lord, in your mercy. God of compassion, bless all who are in any need. Accompany all who are lonely and feeling abandoned, and remind them of your abiding presence. Accompany all who are persecuted and exploited, and open us to your cries. Lord, in your mercy. God of change, bless our transitions. Guide all who are embarking on new stages in life, such as a new job, a new school, or a new community. Strengthen enduring friendships. Enkindle new relationships and interests. Lord, in your mercy. God of comfort, bless all who mourn the deaths of their beloved ones. We pray for Pastor David Biles and his wife Donna upon the death of her mother Joyce Maddox. We pray for your comfort upon the family and friends of Don Watkins, who died from COVID. We pray for the Penberthy family upon the death of Lee's stepfather, Wayne. Renew our confidence in your promise of resurrection and in the light in the world to come. Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy God, breath of life, fire of love, with a mighty wind you brought creation into being. Your fire you led your people into freedom. We praise you for the gift of your Son, who poured out your Spirit on his disciples of every race and nation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, at supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering therefore his death and resurrection and the sending of the Holy and life-giving Spirit, we await his coming again to renew the face of the earth. Send now your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this meal. Anoint us with your gifts of faith and hope and love, so that with thankful hearts we may be witnesses to your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray together the prayer our Lord taught us, saying, shed for you. Amen. Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask, as you have nourished us in this meal. Now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. And how will the Lord bless you and keep you? His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.